Hello everyone. Being out in the bush and being out there live has its technical challenges. We're experiencing some of that now and are working on it as fast as possible to get it sorted and get you back in the vehicle with us.
Shall we try the afternoon again? Good afternoon to all of you. That is what I was desperately trying to mouth, was saying hello and that we were working on our tick issues that we were experiencing there. Our audio wasn't working all that clearly. Now, I'm fairly certain that it's working perfectly now, but if it isn't, please could you let us know on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or just drop us an email on questions@wildearth.tv. If it feels a little bit odd to you, or you can't hear what I'm saying, if you cannot hear what I'm saying at all, then, well, I guess you probably won't be letting us know that to send through that you can't. Nevertheless, Regina, I'm glad that you were able to interpret my attempted sign language. Whoopsie, I didn't drive off the road there. And see it for what it was. We did show you some lovely impala rams briefly, as well as a breeding herd of impala that seems to really like that particular patch, that particular clearing patch on Impala Road, the aptly known Impala Road. Here we go. Thank you, everybody. Apparently the sound is working absolutely fine. Brent was off the vehicle going for a walk to see if he can't follow up on Karula. Now, how on earth she managed to fly to the southern side of Juma without leaving a footprint on the ground is a mystery to all of us. It's one of those extraordinary things about Karula. But nevertheless, she did, and I know that Brent gave you that update that she had crossed back. So fingers crossed, when you next see Brent, he will be with a leopard watching through the camera. Meantime, it's fairly quiet out here in terms of animals that we've been seeing. I think the thick vegetation, the thick summertime vegetation, definitely having an impact on the visibility. There's one lone little steenbok in amongst those impala rams. Raced away. The impala rams were sort of half-heartedly rutting at times in that sighting, and this poor steenbok found itself caught up in the middle of it and dashed away. Now, for those of you watching the Juma Dam camera, you might even before the show have seen that young elephant bull chasing a nyala around. Now, just to give you a heads up, there is an elephant male, or a bull elephant, that is currently on quarantine. It's not our friend with the pierced ear, or the hole in his ear. He has also a flap, a cut flap in his ear. And if we do see him coming down the road towards us, we're going to just give him a nice wide berth. He's chased me 3 times today. He's just not in a very good mood, which is fair enough. First was at Bothelsook Dam early this morning, where he came barreling out of the dam to come and say hello. At least I assume that's what he was going to do, shake my hand. And then we saw him once again and he chased us again. And then this afternoon when I tried to get from where I live to camp in order to prep for drive, he chased Brent and I backwards down quarantine again. Oh, if we see him coming, we'll just do a quick U-turn and go off in the opposite direction. Not sure what's got him so unhappy, it is a must. And it's something that we've discussed at length about the impact that the drought is going to have on animal behavior and increased tension. Chandra, is that bug still on my head that just landed there, or is it taken off? I think it was just a minor collision. Oh, I was hoping we could use it, but it is gone now. I just felt the impact. Yes, the drought is going to have a tremendous effect on the animals' behavior in the future. And it's important for all of us to just bear that in mind as we go through our day-to-day life. Afternoon, Angie. Welcome to our sunset safari. You were wondering if both of the Matimba males are alive and well, because apparently you saw information from Sean at Londolozi that they were both doing fine. Angie, I can't confirm either way. That news hasn't trickled across to us yet in terms of whether or not there was a rumor of a fight between the Matimba males and the Majingulan males, and it was rumored that one of the Matimbas was badly injured. I'm going to wait to just see photographs and to see that they are confirmed, either side of that story is confirmed. As we've spoken about regularly, animals show an incredible amount of resilience, and what to us might be a mortal wound for them is something that they can eventually shrug off over the course of a couple of weeks. They don't get as infected as we do. So fingers crossed he is alive and well. If not, there will come a time when it will be the end of the reign of the Matimbas. They are relatively older in terms of their lifespan and in terms of a male lion's life expectancy. They have managed to father, from what we can understand, or you know, from what we're assuming, they have managed to father another set generation of cubs with a Salala female. So that at least is a comfort if they are injured or if one of them has died. I wish I could tell you more, Angie. We will find out in the next few days. That news will trickle through. I'm just very wary of propagating any rumors like that I haven't confirmed myself. I'd rather not give you a complete sort of... I don't want to tell you something that isn't true. I don't want to give you false hope, and I don't want to give you false despair either. Hello, piggies. I love this little sounder. They have become so relaxed with us that we can actually sit and watch. It has been a while since we've seen them. I've seen them a few times on my way to the start of the safari, on the way to the Birmingham boys at that kill on Arethusa. Hello. They've grown tremendously. There's one particularly large individual. They're all fairly stocky pigs. Quite large, although their tusks are still... I mean, these are young piglets, or just past the age at which we'd call them a piglet. You can see how the tusks are only just starting to come through. That's a young male. That's on his elbows. Actually, it's on his wrists, not his elbows. I don't want to perpetuate inaccurate information there. There's Mom on the right and her teenage son on the left. Oh, somebody's been spending some time in the mud. They're really enjoying this area at the moment because there are so many different pans and places for them to wallow and cool off in. Although it's not as baking hot as it has been over the last few months, it's still warm enough. And they must be absolutely thrilled to have all of this fresh green grass to feed on. Shoots and flowers, and I cannot believe how the vegetation has flourished since the rains. What do you think, little pig? Are you happy as well? I think so. Can you guys hear that whistling call? Let's just see if it happens again. I'm going to be quiet for a moment. Oh, I was hoping it would do it again. I was going to quiz you about which bird that is. For those of you who are relatively new to these safaris and you want to know a little bit about telling the difference between male and female warthogs, I mentioned that there is a female with her teenage son. Have a look at the warts around their face, the warts that give them their name. The female on the right has two, one under each eye, and that is it. But if we, at some point, if one of the males starts to sort of move further out into the open, you should be able to see that they have four of these. There we go, perfect. Four of these so-called warts. One underneath each eye, and then one a little bit closer, or a little bit further down the nose. Now, they're not warts, as their name might imply. They're grisly sort of pieces of cartilage and connective tissue that allow for extra protection of the sensitive bits, particularly between fighting males competing for a female. Now, those of you who are observant enough and have been watching The Lion King, you will then be realizing now that a Pumba, for all that he was... Okay, first of all, we're not even going to talk about how the bird calls as I'm talking. We're not even going to talk about his relationship with the meerkat in this particular area. That would be pretty much physically impossible. But he is, in fact, Pumba, physiologically, as designed by the animators, is a girl. So just your little surprise Lion King lesson for the day. Get a little bit closer to these pigs. Hopefully, at the same time, the bird that is calling will call again, because I want to see if our birders out there can tell me which particular bird that is. Very, very unique and easily identifiable call. Once you know it, you'll never forget it. I agree, Catherine. Welcome to the Sunset Safari. You were saying that you love warthogs and you love the way that they run with their tails in the air. I always, whenever I see warthog, I think automatically of Tara, who was one of our previous directors, and I... Here's the bird calling again. I'm not sure if you can hear it, that... But I'm saying that I think of Tara when I look at warthogs, not for any insulting reason, which I realize that may have sounded fairly insulting. I didn't mean it at all like that. But she also absolutely loved warthogs, and we would go out of our way to try and put a warthog on screen for Tara. In the beginning, we never used to enjoy sightings of warthogs like this. They were always so nervous. And basically, all we saw of them was exactly what Catherine was talking about, a bottom disappearing off into the bush with tails in the air. Now, that's another safari wives' tale propagated by guides occasionally. Here's that whistle again. I'm sort of determined to try and ask you what that is now, so I'm just going to sit not quietly, but I will keep listening, and then as soon as the call starts again, we'll stop and we'll just listen to it and we'll see if you can figure out which bird is calling. Not one we see that often, but definitely one that we hear fairly regularly. Let's see if we can't catch you out on that. But yes, one of the sort of the... It's going to call again because there's another one calling. Come on. Oh well, I guess you win some, you lose some. But yes, that's sort of the rumor about warthogs being, their skin being so tight that they can only have their tails up and their eyes closed, or their tails down and their eyes open, because their skin is so tight. That, of course, is complete nonsense. This is a story that the reason they run with their tails up in the air is because when they run through the grass, they don't want to get grass seeds in their eyes. They have to close their eyes, and in order to do that, they have to sort of lift their tail. Definitely not the case. All right, I think I might be flummoxed by this bird. He doesn't seem to want to cooperate. I'm not sure if you could hear it or not. If you think you might know what it is, just let me know. Well done, Rebecca. There we go. Yes, well done, Rebecca. Already straight off the mark. It was indeed a red-crested corhan. the relative of the black-bellied bustard, of course the red black-bellied bustard having one of the best calls in the bush, and I think probably in my top five bird sounds to hear. I'd love to hear from you what your favorite bird calls are as well that you've heard out here and that you've learned, come to learn to identify in your time watching Safari Live. I bet some of you will say woodland kingfisher. I also love the woodland kingfisher for about the first 3 days that they're back, and then when they're sitting chirp chirping outside your window at 4 o'clock every single morning, the joy or the wonder of it starts to wear thin, but I still welcome them back every single year. So I would love to hear what your favorite bird calls are. Please send them through to me. I think it would be really interesting. Geraldine in Final Control. Jerry, absolutely. That's one of my top of my list as well, or one of the tops of my list, is the call of the pearl-spotted owlet. Wonderful sound. Chandra, I thought you were an owl responding to me for a second there. That wasn't my best effort ever. But my lips are a little bit too dry for imitating calls. Yes, Rebecca, that whistling call was the red-crested corhan. What other favorites could we have? I'm quite a big fan of the chagra. Oh, brilliant. That's a brilliant one. Lou in Final Control has said one of her favorite things to hear is the ground hornbill. That very gentle coo-coo-coo-coo-coo, low-pitched, deep, far-carrying sound that you hear first thing in the morning. Here's a little birdie that I would love to ask what his favorite calls are. You got him there, Jean-André. Aww. Apparently he didn't want to tell me what his favorite bird calls are. The reason I stopped for him is that, unlike me, the fork-tailed drongo is an excellent bird call mimic, and in fact has been known to fool even the most experienced of twitchers or bird watchers and ornithologists with their ability to imitate. One of my favorite things about that is their reaction to the presence of a cuckoo that might attempt to parasitize their nest. As you know, cuckoos being brood parasites, they don't raise their own chicks, they just dump them with the host species and off they go to live the life of freedom and lack of responsibility and care. Hey, look at this. This is so cool. Andre's just handed this to me. He is awesome. He's gonna jump straight into my face. Please don't jump. Look at this jumping spider. He's looking at me. Hello. He is so beautiful. Thank you, guy. Thank you, Jean-André. Hello. Oh. backing up. The problem is, buddy, I can turn. Please don't bite me. Oh, here we go. Look at the white stripe down his back. Oh, he doesn't want to turn his back on me. It's so weird being under such scrutiny. Their eyes are so clearly visible. There's sort of the two pairs of them, two forward facing and then two on the other side, staring. I feel as though now I'm involved in a staring competition. Look how fluffy he is. He is absolutely gorgeous. Okay, buddy, I want to show everyone how cool the markings are on your back, but you really don't want me to. Backing up. Shame, he's on some kind of reverse treadmill here. All right, it's okay. I'm not going to. Now, these guys can launch themselves incredible distances when they want to, and there's such a wide variety of jumping spider that I wouldn't be able to, off the top of my head, tell you which species this is, but it's most definitely a jumping spider. They've got these compact bodies that he really doesn't want to show you. Where have you gone, boy? There you are. Compact bodies and powerful back legs. And if he does leap, if he does choose to leap, he is going to go straight into my nose or onto my head. He is fascinating. very active spiders. So they're not ambush or sort of web-based spiders, although he is, of course, able to spin a web. But they actively search for and hunt down their insect or invertebrate prey. He is very cool. Well spotted, Jandre. I don't really want to take him on the ride with us. I'm worried about him getting squidged. So I think we should release him back into the wild where he belongs. I think he wanted to be famous and now the pressure's just got too much for him. Where's he gone? Here he is. Please don't jump on my head. I promise I'm going to release you. It'd be very funny if he did jump on my head though. Oh. Myself. Sorry about that. Here we go. I'm going to get him out now. I just want to reattach my microphone. It's hooked as I got out of the car. Okay, come on. Out you go. You can't live in the camera lens forever. He's very determined. There you go. Come on. Oh, goodness. Yeah. No, not back in there. This is turning out to be more difficult than I intended it to be. Okay, now he's on me. Okay. Look, you didn't want to be famous, but now you are on my arm. Isn't he cool? Well, there we go. Chandra, you can have your lens back. And as I try and get rid of him again. There you go. Okay, come now. This is getting ridiculous. I'm very fond of you, but it's time for you to go. There we go. Sorted. And he's back in the wild where he belongs. Not hitchhiking with us down the road. Very cool. So Ellen, going back to our favorite bird calls, and apparently thank you, you're all sending through your responses. Ellen has said the black-headed oriole. I can't do it today. My bird imitation is not up to scratch. Lips far too tired. It is a beautiful call. And Indiana James has said the let's go get a beer Franklin. Which one is that now? Is it a Cokie? A Cokie Franklin. That's interesting. Indiana James, you've actually just taught me something. It's obviously something that the other presenters have used, the other guides have used, that I haven't caught on to, but now I'll never ever forget that. Cokie Franklin, must be. I agree. James and Jacqueline are on my team when it comes to the black-bellied bustard. Why can't I whistle today? This is so disappointing. It's such a bad time for me to have brought up all these bird calls. I can't do it. I can't whistle today. There are no sounds coming out from my lips. But they do this incredible whistle and then end the part of their call with a champagne cork popping. Marilyn has suggested the call of the fiery-necked nightjar. Good one. Really good one. We spoke about that yesterday on the drive and how beautiful that call is. And it's a call I always associate with summer nights in the African bush. The Barrow's eagle owl is also an amazing call. Cat in Tampa is having a good giggle at our spider passenger and was wondering if he bites. I can. It's not venomous, it's not dangerous to us. I just didn't want to disturb him too much or hurt him in any way, trying to get him off the camera lens, but he did decide that he wanted to be on my arm instead. So cat, they can bite, not painfully, not majorly, definitely not something to write home about. Actually, there's an expression that will no longer be in use for much longer. Darlene in New Hampshire, you were saying that since watching, I've convinced you to like hyenas and warthogs, but it's not going to happen with a spider. On the way on our left there is my friend, the elephant. Can you see him at the back there, Jandre? It's far away. Could be him. It could also be a large bull that wandered in from Kruger that Brent and myself both saw. He's not aggressive or anything. He's just quite scared of vehicles. This morning when we tried to go have a closer look at him, he just kept moving away from us. Either way, a big elephant on the opposite slope. I don't think we'll be investigating. Just in case, we'll leave him be. So, Darlene, I haven't managed to convince you on the spider front. I spoke about the young bull being angry, and Rocky Knight is just wondering, surely then the presence of enough or mature bulls would go a long way into curbing that. I know that that's something that I have spoken about before, and in fact it was an approach followed by the Pilansberg many, many years ago, where they'd introduced elephants there that were traumatized for one reason or another, and they were young males that were growing up without the guidance of older bulls. And as a result, they started acting out in the strangest of ways, one of which was killing rhino and other large animals for no apparent or clear reason. And they actually solved that problem by bringing in larger males to sort them out. Rocky Knight, this particular elephant, he's not, I wouldn't describe him as angry at all. I tend to veer. As people, so I don't see him as angry, but he's also not that young. He's not a teenager. I wouldn't classify him as a teenager. I'd say that he's over the age of 25. Yes, perhaps the presence of a larger bull would calm things down. In fact, almost definitely the presence of a larger bull would calm him down a little bit. You'll probably even find that when he's distracted by a breeding herd, he could be a completely different animal. Maybe he just needs some time and some space to spend time apart, and that's what we'll just let him, go about his daily business and just not get any or put ourselves in a situation where, because we know in advance that he's not happy. Oh, I've been chattering away, giving Brent some time to go and track Karula. Let's find out from him how it's going.
So Karula continues to elude. So I saw a couple of tracks, but then I got engaged in a very interesting game of Dodge the Dugger Boy. So there were a lot of buffalo bulls there. So I still haven't managed to check some of the areas as well as I'd like. I might wait a little bit and go back once those Dugger Boys have moved off. But the top side of the little river system that I think she might be in, there was nothing there. The bottom side had a few too many buffalo to wander around too safely. So I decided discretion is the better part of valor. And I did have my anti-buffalo device with me, which is any form of stick I might find to throw at them if they decide to become cheeky. But just in case she's passed through and gone to the next block, we're just going to check very carefully. So also we're checking in all the nice big prominent trees to make sure that she doesn't have a kill up in the tree. So we are just moving very, very slowly and checking for tracks and checking up on the big prominent marulas around, seeing if she's maybe hoisted whatever she might have killed. So looking for tree climbing impala, tree climbing duiker, and tree climbing stenbok. Now, Karula doesn't normally grab an adult impala. It's a bit heavy for her to hoist in one go. She has to take out the stomach in that first. Nope, false alarm, sorry, Dave. So that's why we often find her hunting on the crests through those monkey orange thickets. It is a really good spot for stenbok and duiker, which are definitely her preferred prey species. So it is a very exciting time here with potentially lots of little cubs all around. So the next couple of months is going to be amazing. Whoa, that was close. Land Rovers are not known for very good doors. So I was leaning against my door and I nearly went for a ride. Let's see, maybe that'll be a bit better. Okay, that seems it. So Land Rovers are actually quite renowned for the doors popping open. Fortunately, my lightning reflexes prevented me from falling out of the car while it was moving. So, unfortunately, these two blocks that she might be in are very big blocks. So, it requires quite a bit of power walking almost to get through them. But in doing so, because we're walking quite quickly, so we can get back to the vehicle, so we're not running around tracking during the whole drive. And so sometimes we do miss things. And it'll be great once James is back, and then one of us will be on a tracking team where we can actually spend a full couple of hours on foot in the bush trying to find these animals. Oh, sounds like a nice bird party up ahead. There's the bird party. You can hear them. Just a bit far off the road. It's always good to just stop and listen for a bit in case we get some alarms. These little cisticulas making lots of noise. A little bit far for this camera lens, so we will continue on. Hopefully we'll find something close by shortly. Nigel is wondering, are we going to get a change of animals with a change of season? No, Nigel, and unfortunately not. We definitely might be able to see some animals better. So as we go into winter and the grass dies down, and there's very little grass to die down after our very dry summer, what we will get then is we'll be able to see quite a lot into the bush, so some of the smaller nocturnal mammals we might have a better chance at seeing. So things like civets, genets, white-tailed mongoose. But the same players will be here, so to speak. It won't be very green at all. It'll be quite dry, and a lot of the trees will lose their leaves. And it does make for much easier game viewing, much easier tracking as well. So one would think when it rains, oh, nice, you can see tracks nicely. Only if they walk in the mud, but normally after rain, it actually compacts the ground, makes it very, very hard. and very difficult to track. So the drier it is, the better it is for tracking. So it does generally increase your predator sightings in the dry season. Also, the herbivores are not at their peak form. And I think this year is going to be a particularly tough year because we did have a very dry summer with that. So the herbivores are going to struggle a little bit through the dry season, which will be good for the lions, leopards, and hyenas. And they'll be able to catch lots and without exerting too much effort, because especially towards October, the buffalo, impala, the ones that are a bit old or a bit young or a little bit sick, are going to be much easier to catch than they would be if we'd had a normal rainy season. So we don't really have four seasons like you do in the Northern Hemisphere. We pretty much got hot and cold, and hot is wet and cold is dry. And that's pretty much how our seasons go here. And there is an autumn, and the leaves on some of the trees do change, but it's not nearly as noticeable as it is in the Northern Hemisphere. There's some of my friends, not the best view, but who I was playing hide around the bush with a little bit earlier. Not too far from here either. Not something you want to get too close to on foot. And you can see how thick the bush is at the moment, so you've got to be quite careful when you walk. There are buffalo balls everywhere. Every little pan, every little mud wallow seems to have a couple of balls around. So it does make walking a little bit treacherous, but also quite fun. And you are on hyper alert, so you don't accidentally stumble upon a buffalo. Now, when walking, buffalo and elephant are probably the two biggest threats we face. And specifically with buffalo, these old bulls, so they're between about 12 and 15 years old generally, past their prime. So they're not able to compete in the breeding herd. So they form these little bachelor groups that stay around the mud wallows. They don't move too far, they're a bit old, a bit deaf, so they tend to get a fright. And sometimes you surprise each other at quite close range. And of course, with a buffalo bull, he's a bit bigger than me. I tend to prefer to give them right of way. I have had actually quite a funny, I think I was tracking quarantine. Must have been in May last year. For those of you who don't know, quarantine is a young male leopard. From Karula's last successful litter. And it wasn't too far from here. And I'd been tracking him for a while. And just as I found him, I was on my way back to the vehicle, and this buffalo bull started following me. And we played round and round the termite mound till I could confuse him enough that I could get away. I think he just picked up my scent and he was investigating. So Dave, we're going to check these trees now on this side in case she managed to get past that block where I was walking and she's in here somewhere. So we've done a loop around this quite big block and nothing yet. So the next block we'll loop is this one. Unfortunately, these are some of the bigger blocks without roads through the Monjuma. We have found Karula many times in all of these blocks. I'm hoping today will be no different. So James Richard says he wonders who will be the first presenter to fall out of the vehicle while live. Well, I'm not sure. Dave, who do you think?
perhaps James.
I think James as well, but I didn't want to say it. possibly James. Possibly me. Possibly Jamie. Well, Final Control thinks Jamie's going to be the first. I disagree. I definitely think it will be James when he is distracted by something. Or when he's singing. for the joy of the morning. Just very carefully checking every marula tree. So while we check every marula tree for queen caroules, let's go to Jamie, who's probably with one of the individuals I was trying to avoid not so long ago.
Could well be. You never know. Either way, I've encountered something of a dam wall roadblock at Treehouse Dam. Seems as though our buffalo friend has decided that this is the spot that he wants to spend the rest of his afternoon on. Oh, no, there he goes. I was going to say it might be quite entertaining to watch him move down the dam wall, but I think he's decided to take the slightly gentler angle at the other side of the dam wall. Oh, stopped again. There's a couple more lying up on the side of the dam wall, along with one enjoying an afternoon wallow. And that sound you can hear, that sounds like a hammer on metal, is a blacksmith lapwing. Not, by the way, one of my favorite calls. Perhaps I should have asked you which bird calls are your least favorite. Oxpeckers, the call of the oxpeckers, I would say it ranks one of my favorite calls, but not for the reason that it's a particularly beautiful call, but because it is so useful in warning you while you're walking through the bush. I know that Brent was talking about encounters with buffalo and walking buffalo. Oh, that looks... Look how happy he is. Oh, there we go. I know this gentleman. Oh, no. I missed the descent of the buffalo down the dam wall I was watching. What a pity. Oh, well. Not a disaster. But yes, I know Brent was talking about walking around with buffalo. And I think we've all, as guides, had encounters with them. They do tend to pop out in the most surprising of places. And at the moment, the vegetation is particularly dense. So that's why I enjoy the call of the oxpeckers. Because although it's not particularly pretty or nice to listen to, it is exceptionally useful in either locating an animal or warning one about it. Decided to join his friend. I'm just listening to game drive updates. And the update about Tundi and Tingana still mating on Torchwood, so they're around, just to keep you updated in that respect. And this is a very relaxed way to spend a... What day is it? Friday.
Good Friday.
It's Good Friday, thank you. Apparently it's Friday today. What a lovely way to spend, I guess, any afternoon, but a Friday afternoon is a good approach as well. Sorry, I do tend to lose my handle on exactly where we are one day from the next. I know this buffalo bull. He's actually one of the guys that he's okay to encounter on foot. I've met him once or twice. And he just looks at you for a while, and I've wandered off, and he's wandered off in our different directions. So we often speak about how we speak about them as being dangerous. Of course, they are, and they demand respect, but at the same time, they're never going to... No animal out here is going to set out to stalk and to hunt you or to kill you. It's just when they get a bit of a fright. But they're definitely an animal that demands and deserves respect. A very noisy lapwing as well. Buffalo are an interesting one. One of the reasons why they're counted as particularly dangerous is a lot of the time when they do charge, which isn't all the time, but a lot of the time when they do charge, they're a bit less likely to turn, as opposed to something like a lion or an elephant, which a lot of the time, in fact, all of my encounters where I've been charged by lions and elephants, they've turned before they've come close to me, thank goodness. Close is relative. but they have turned without smacking me. Darlene was saying that when a moose is about to charge, they sort of, their hair raises and they give a head shake, and she was wondering if you could read any signs of buffalo behavior that might be similar. Darlene, yes, absolutely. The first sign of that a buffalo is, there's a couple of signs you look for. The first is that it's seen you. That's the very characteristic head up pose. So they have this posture where they lift their noses so that they can smell better. Ears out, body language completely still otherwise, with just their head sniffing. Now at that point, the sighting usually goes with the buffalo turning around and running away. So it's not a sign of charging then. In a couple of head shakes, and then what they often do is they'll take a couple of steps towards you. Even then, that's not a sign that they're going to charge. That's investigation. They're coming to see what you are and what if they can get a better handle, because of course their eyesight isn't terribly good. But head down is usually a good sign. They might be in a bit of trouble, but it might be time to start considering the nearest tree. And whilst there are multiple thorn trees in Africa, in fact, sometimes seems as though most of them are rather thorny. I promise you that when you've got 900 kilograms, so just under 2,000 pounds of buffalo moving at 15 meters per second, so 45 feet per second, it doesn't really matter if the tree has thorns, or in fact, if it is the spindliest tree in the area. He's gonna settle down in the mud. There's our bird that's making all that noise. He's just on the side of the bank. There he is. That's the one chattering away. You can just watch him call for a little bit. Speaking a bit about being in the bush and on foot, Tom in Dallas was wondering about how we find the balance between being stealthy and finding things and moving rapidly and the different ways in which you can approach things. So Tom, it depends on what your purpose for the bushwalk is, and there's different approaches to different circumstances. Now, if, for example, what we mainly do with our bushwalks is generally, although if we find a nice safe encounter that we can do with elephants, for example, then we will approach that. But for the most part, our bushwalks are geared towards the smaller, lesser seen side of the bush. And in that case, walking stealthily is not really a problem. You know, you're quite happily to just walk through the bush. Steph is usually with us. He's scouting ahead, finding us all manner of interesting and exciting things to see. Then sometimes you have a mad rush where you go and you find an animal, like we did with the last bushwalk I did with the lioness. Unfortunately, in the mad rush to get to the lioness, the battery fell out of the camera. So we never managed to get it live, which is very sad. It's a combination of things. What you might be also referring to is we've often spoken, or I've often spoken at least, about presenting oneself to the animal. We did it the other day with a herd of elephants that was approaching through Sandy Patch that was, we were exactly in the wrong place with the wind, so they wouldn't have smelt us initially, or they might have caught a whiff of us, but not knowing exactly where we were. That combined with the fact that they were moving quite fast through the bush meant that they were at some point going to see us, and it was better for them to see us sooner rather than later so that we didn't surprise them. So what we did was we did what's known as presenting ourselves to the animals. So stepping out into the open, whistling, talking, just generally letting the animal know that you are there. And I found sometimes the same thing, depending of course on where you are, the same thing works for cat sightings on foot as well. Because once they know you're there, pretending that you're not and whispering and sort of sneaking around and hiding immediately means that you're behaving like a potential predator. And that's what scares them. They're capable of reading body language far better than us, so something creeping towards you in their world means something that potentially might attack them. Generally, though, the aim of the bushwalk is to avoid the animals being aware of your presence completely. Of course, that doesn't always work, but that generally is our intention when we're out in the bush on foot, and that's the best way for us to go about at least trying to walk through and explore this wonderful area on foot. And being on foot is the best way of following them. That being said, I know that Brent's still been out tracking. Let's find out how his tracking has gone.
So we're still in search. Sorry, I just thought I saw a track as we linked there. I just want to go back a little bit. There's a hyena track, but there's another set of tracks there. I'm just trying to determine. A small hyena track, so. We are looking, and Karula is quite a small female, so she's got very small, delicate tracks. So when the ground's a bit hard, can be very difficult to spot. So we've checked this whole sort of southwestern sector now, so there's only one sort of other option. Being Karula, she went in the complete opposite direction they saw her crossing. So I'm gonna do one last gander through here before I'm just gonna go east, because they said she was going west. And we all know how that Karula likes to do a zigzag, a loop-de-loop. A changing of plans, so hopefully going the opposite to way to which she was going will prove more fruitful than searching around here. Now, I've walked through these blocks now and still no luck, so I think it's time to go east. Who knows what else might be out in the east? You never know what could be around the next corner. Last night's sunset safari was a perfect example. After spending much time looking for leopards yesterday, both Jamie and myself found different leopards within about a minute of each other. So that's the wonderful thing about a safari. It can happen just like that. Let's see what area Jamie's working quickly. Oh, there, don't need to see what area Jamie's working. We can see Jamie. There she is on the other side. We're gonna try see them. There we go. There we go. Quickly, Dave, zoom, zoom, zoom. There we go. And there's Connor, the carnivore, on the back going on a drive. There we go, everyone. So I'm just gonna talk to Jamie on the radio quickly. Jamie, what's your plan from here? Sorry, go again. Jamie. Still silence. Okay, well, she doesn't want to talk to us. That's fine. We'll just go on our own way then.
Sorry, Brent, go ahead.
Ah, there we go. What's your plan from here, from Treehouse Dam?
I can't go much further away from quarantine without signal
managing.
I'm going back to
quarantine. Copy. I'm gonna head east and see maybe if she maybe went towards Mumba Road.
Okay, copy. Where did you have last tracks?
In the middle of the block between Twin Dams and Weaver's Nests. General direction northeast-ish. But the ground is quite hard.
Okay, copy, thanks. I'll keep an eye out along the
cut
line area.
Copy, thank you. There we go. Just in case Karula has tricked me yet again, I've just asked Jamie to have a careful look in case she went through into that area while we head to the east to see what can be found there. Thank you. almost seems the best way to find Karula is to not look for Karula. James Richard's wondering, from an evolutionary standpoint, what is the reason some of the large herbivores have poor eyesight? Well, it's quite a funny one. So I'd say the only really large herbivore that has really bad eyesight is rhinos. But people say buffalo and elephant, they have good eyesight. I mean, I wouldn't say it's bad at all. It's just not as good as an impala, for example. And from an evolutionary standpoint, the reason for this is that they're very big, so very little messes with them. So they're quite safe in their size. So that's probably why some of the other senses aren't as developed. I was just over on the other side of this dry riverbed where I was playing round and around the Tumbuiti tree with the buffalo bulls. I was hoping that she had moved either the cubs or a kill into this very hard to access little river system, but alas, I've walked the whole river system and she's definitely not there. She was being very sneaky and hiding under a bush. But I did a check under most bushes. Tim on YouTube says he thinks Karula can only be found when she wants to be found. Sneaky leopard. Well, she is a sneaky leopard, but I don't think that's the case. I think if we were lucky enough to have Mr. Renius here, he would find her in two ticks. He is just so incredible at seeing tracks that we would not see. So it is amazing, but by no means are we bad trackers. He's just a genius when it comes to tracking. Absolute, utter, and amazing tracker. And literally, spending time with him just leaves you gobsmacked. So Stephen on Twitter would like to know, are your guide's licenses or tracking licenses, tracker licenses, restricted to the one country you passed it? Generally, yes, and in South Africa, it even goes as far as to the province or the state that you're operating in. So it is very much so. So different countries will have different rules, and so it is very much country-specific, those guide licenses. And in a lot of countries, it's very, very difficult to get a guide license if you're not a citizen. So the point of that is same as if anyone from South Africa wanted to go work in America. It would be on the onus of the company or whatnot to prove that you have a set of skills that is not readily available in that country already. So, for example, when I went to Tanzania, they had to motivate that I had more experience with international guests and dealing with game on foot than the majority of the guides in Tanzania, so I could get a work permit. And then only once you've got a work permit, then you can apply for your guides license. Gabon was a bit of a different thing. Gabon, there is no format yet, and it was quite exciting that I got to go in there and help develop some of those procedures that will come to be later once the tourism is a bit more developed in that part of the world. is a beautiful, beautiful evening, and hopefully we're going to find some kitty cats. But if we don't, it's still wonderful being out here and experiencing the last days of summer. Let's play a game while we're in search of animals. And I'm gonna let Dave choose the theme now and let you guys choose last time. So Dave, what quiz are we gonna play? We're gonna play a mammal quiz, the bird quiz, the tree quiz.
Quite like a mammal quiz.
A mammal quiz? Yeah. Dave would like a mammal quiz. So we're gonna get Dave to answer with the viewers. So once we'll see. If he's just a pretender to the throne. And so, let's think. Nice mammal quiz for everyone. Let me think. Let us think. Aha. I think I've got, an elephant in front of me. Hello, little man. Well, since there's an elephant in front of me, why don't we do a quiz on elephant? It's a young bull. He's not looking too relaxed. Let's let him meander past. Probably around early 20s. Let's just move forward a bit. To watch his grey behind disappear. Okay, mammal quiz. First mammal quiz. What country in Africa has the largest population of African savanna elephants? And it's a multi-pronged question. And the next one is, which country in Africa has the largest population of forest elephants? So there we go, there's the two questions. If you know the answers to those questions, pop me an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. I'm just going forward a little bit. Here we go. So what country in Africa has the largest population of African savanna or bush elephants? And part B, what country in Africa has the largest population of forest elephants? Off he disappears. So what I'm hoping, that young bull is trailing a breeding herd. So I'm gonna pop around the other side and maybe we'll find a nice big herd with lots of little babies. So Dave, you ready? You think you've got this one covered?
First one I might have.
First one he thinks he has, not so sure about the second one. We're going to get quite a spectacular sunset this evening. So just a quick reminder to anyone who might have logged in a little bit late. First Colonial High School will be joining us for the last 20 minutes of the sunset safari today. So always good to encourage the next generation of conservationists. So just a reminder, for the last 20 minutes, we will be focusing on questions from the kids at First Colonial High. Okay, we're now towards the eastern sectors. Now, there are four Birmingham boys, probably about 900 meters from our... Oh, that's gonna be difficult. Maybe he'll come back. She'll come back. No. Oh, maybe, yes, no. Let's see if it lands and we can get a bit closer. So what we've got there, it looks like it might land. It's going to be incredibly difficult to film, but we will try. And a fascinating insect. And now we test. Oh, she, it looked like she did land. Did she catch something? Now, it is called a spider hunting wasp. They are massive wasps. They actually sound like little helicopters when they fly around. There we go. It's getting there. Nice, Dave. Very difficult to try predict where the spider hunting wasp is going to go. Well, here we go. You can see hunting at the moment. So what they'll do, they hunt caterpillars and they hunt spiders. And what they do is they'll sting them, then lay their eggs inside and then bury them, giving their larval phase a nice start in life. And now I think we're going to get quite a spectacular sky. What do you think, Dave? Beautiful is Dave's answer. Look at that. So I think it's so beautiful we should set up a time lapse. Now let's find the right spot. Answers in. Safari Dean, Sammy, and Lady Macbeth. So we had a couple of incorrect ones in there. Kenya, no. Kenya's actually got one of the smallest populations of savannah elephants left in Africa. The biggest is Botswana. So well done, Dave. Dave is happy. And then what do you have for the forest elephants, Dave?
DRC.
DRC is actually incorrect. It used to be, it is the biggest country. But it is now Gabon has the largest population and most well-protected population of forest elephants in Africa. So we're going to have a little fun here. Raisa did get Gabon, so well done, Raisa. So I am going to be very artistic now, and I will be able to show you how artistic. Where did I put that other thing? So. Look at that. There's the buffalo skull. That was the buffalo that was murdered by the Nkuhuma pride. So we're going to now see how artistic we can be. What do you think, Dave? Should we be artistic?
Yes.
We'll put a buffalo skull. How's that look to you, Dave?
Oh, yes.
And then Dave likes this. So we're going to put a GoPro here doing a time lapse. So for those of you who don't know what a time lapse is, it takes a picture sort of every couple of seconds. What do you think? 5 or 10 seconds, Dave?
Five is good, I think.
5 seconds? Yep. Okay. I think maybe we need a little bit more light there. I don't know. So let's see. What do you guys think? The sun is unfortunately already behind the buffalo, but it could be quite stunning. So. Unfortunately, this is a very cracked screen, so I do apologize. But that's what that little camera is seeing. How's that look, Dave?
like that. I'm just making it a bit
longer. There we go. So I will post this video once it's done. So quite an interesting little one.
Perfect.
Perfect. I have the cameraman's approval. So now we just need to go set it. And we'll be back in about an hour to see what it looks like. So we can probably actually have a look at it before the end of the drive. Okay, let's go. Oh, I'm going the wrong way. So while we carry on, let's jump on across to Jamie.
Having had that conversation about my favorite bird calls, we've just encountered a black-bellied bustard and we're in luck because he was calling. So hopefully if I see him start to call, I'm gonna go very quiet. Maybe he'll call for us again. Can you see him there? He's so cryptically colored, you might even have missed him. I don't want to get any closer though, because I'm scared that he's going to run away. He's gonna call. Here it is, that champagne cork head bob. The whistle followed by that popping sound. And hopefully if we just show a little bit of patience, he's gonna move out into the open and do it for us. They just look so comical when they do it. James and Jacqueline, you were saying how you think that's one of your favorite calls. Oh, come on, buddy. One more time for luck. I'm trying to listen and see if I can hear another one of the birds calling that might entice him to join in. Okay, let's try. Let us try and shuffle forward. See if we can't get a different perspective on him. And hopefully he'll call again. We still see you, boy. Aw. He's playing hide and go seek with us. I love the way they walk. I described it the other day, it's almost like they're pulling their body along with their heads when they pull like that. That head goes forward and then it's like they're like a mime pretending to pull its body forward on a rope. Fortunately, he's not being as vocal as I hoped he was going to be. It's a nervous black-bellied bustard. I was thinking about other calls, or other bird calls that I really enjoy as I was driving along, looking for whatever we happen to find. Let's have a look at this beautiful afternoon. It is so stunning. Did you by any chance hear that? He did call again. Just sitting quietly for the moment, hoping that he's going to call again. And just taking in the beauty of the afternoon. And he's vanished. All right. Here he's going to come out into the open again, but he's just not as vocal. We are coming to the end of their breeding season, which is why we don't see them calling as often as we did at the start of summer. Come on, call for us, nice and in the open. the best. They just look so comical as well while they do it. One more time for luck, or is that pushing it? Sure how I feel. Come on, one more time for good luck, Bustard. Nope. I think that, oh. Last time for luck. All right. Yay. At least we did manage to get that on camera. They just look that champagne popping cork sound. Let's try that again. Champagne cork popping sound. Let me just get my words in the right order. It's so comical. And I was just thinking about my favorite bird calls. One that's been mentioned by Jerry in Final Control that we forgot to mention was the fish eagle. And that is a really good point. The fish eagle sound is one that is so intrinsically associated with South Africa. Also one of the most impossible to imitate. I quite like the scopsowl call as well. The brr, brr, that we hear at night. I always think that that's terribly sweet. The chagras, robin chats, larks, all kinds of things out there that make the most wonderful sounds. And that includes some of our larger creatures, and it seems as though Brent has found one to show you. Nope. Never mind. Just to confirm, we're not still live. Okay, sorry about that. It seems as though the elephant that Brent was with was another male, or possibly the same male, that's still a little bit unhappy. But Brent's fine, nothing to stress about, but he just didn't want to stick about in that sighting. Every now and again we just get our wires a little bit crossed in terms of communication. But all is well. We're slowly on our way to the hyena den, just because in this particular, driving in Wendy at the moment, the signal's a little bit restricted as to where we can go. So we've been on the western side of Juma. I've checked all of the roads I can possibly check, apart from quarantine, which we're going to pop to next on our way to the hyena den and just see if we can't figure out what's happening there. Right, and now let us try that once again and see if what Brent has to update you this afternoon.
Look at that, we've just caught up. I can see one big bull in the thickets. We've got this little bull right next to us. And then I can hear some more elephants around. And that guy we saw disappearing, I think is making his way here. It might be a nice breeding herd in the area. Just looking at the age of this Ellie. And it looks like a female there. Hello, little man. Peaceful sitting with Ellies. so we haven't had enough time to have a proper look at them yet. Although the ones I've seen do look relaxed, but they are in this terribly thick block where there's a lot of fallen trees. Let's try to see if we sneak further down the road. There might be some more out in the open. Hey, mister. Oh, yes, so scary. Look how beautiful that was with the light. Millie in Cleveland's wondering if I've ever seen cave elephants. I'm trying to remember which country that is, that they go into a cave. Millie, can you remind me? But I haven't seen them. I'm just trying to remember whether they're forest elephants or savannah elephants. I think they are savannah elephants and they go into a cave. I can't remember exactly where it is. There we go, Kitum Cave in Kenya. And they go in there for mineral salts and water. So I haven't been lucky enough to see those elephants yet, but hopefully one day. And he's gonna, I can hear more elephants all around us. So I'm just hoping. There's a nice big breeding herd a little bit further away. Let's just try sneak again down the road. Hey, little man. What you up to? So it's always important to just move really calmly and slowly when you're this close to an Ellie, even a little one like this. You can see that exquisite light in his eye there. Look at that. Oh, he's even got mud in his eyelashes from his last mud bath. Beautiful stuff. I love spending time with these animals. There's a peaceful sense about them. Okay, let's go check around the corner if there's some more out in the open. If not, we'll skedaddle back here. Unfortunately, it seems like a lot of them are right down in those thickets there. Just hoping maybe, just go a little bit further to see if there's any more Ellies there. And it does seem that most of them are down in that very, very thick area. So we'll just find a spot to turn around, we'll go back to that little boy. So I heard you guys got some wonderful screenshots of that young Ellie bull in that magnificent light. Maybe we can get some better ones. he's crossed the road already. Yes, we see you. Bertie on Twitter, speaking about eyesight, says, you heard that giraffes have some of the best eyesight on the savannah. Is that true? They do have very good eyesight, and also coupled with the fact that they're so tall, which makes it so effective. So you can just see behind him, there's an elephant leg through there. And I don't think it's a breeding herd. I actually think it's a little group of bulls. I think there's three of them in total. Some older, some, and this young guy who's decided to throw his lot in with the big boys. That just blasting some air out of his trunk. It's taking advantage of all the grass around at the moment. So it's not uncommon for a young bull to abandon the herd if there are some bigger boys around. They don't really like to be too alone at this time. They're still a little bit nervous. First time away from mom and all that. Now you can see the bigger one at the back. Very, very peaceful. Just move back, we might get a better view of that bigger bull. You got a gap there.
Very much, yes. That's good.
There we go, there's the slightly older bull, the one we first spotted. Hayley on Twitter is wondering how long can their tusks get? Well, Hayley, they can get quite long. I think the record for longest tusks is probably quite a lot longer than me. So over 2 meters. There we go. Hello, little man. Feeding right next to us. Isn't this wonderful? So great. Now, where are you off to now? Here comes the head shake. Yes, you're very big. You're very scary and very tough, and we are shivering in our boots. Very common elephant bull behavior. Donna says she would love to just be able to touch an elephant's skin just to know what it feels like. Well, Donna, it's very, very rough, very, very coarse. I wouldn't say quite like sandpaper, but very rough. I have been lucky enough to touch a few elephants over the years during game captures, but very difficult to describe it as a sort of like a very rough hide, very rough leather.
Peter in Florida is saying he's noticed sometimes the elephants don't put their foot all the way down. Is there any reason for that? Probably just resting. You can see there he's actually using it to help him pluck stuff. There we go. Moving some of the stuff he doesn't want out of the way. But they're probably just having a bit of a rest on that foot. Not uncommon. You see lots of different animals do that, not put full weight on their an individual foot. You notice horses do it quite often from a domestic point of view. Turn around quickly. That older bull is. Come out of the bush a little bit. Hello, mister. Well, he's not as relaxed as the young one, so we're not going to pressurize him. Okay. Well, you can see he's not so relaxed, so I think we'll leave them be. We're getting to that time of the night when a lot of the, or hopefully the leopards are going to start moving. So we're going to leave them and see what else we can find. So let's jump back on with Jamie, who has a spectacular sunset to show you.
How spectacular is the sunset? Since it has been such a peaceful afternoon and we've got such an extraordinary view, I'm just going to sit quietly and we can just watch the sun as it goes behind the Drakensberg Mountains. And gone. Beautiful. We've had some really, truly spectacular sunsets. This change in weather bringing all kinds of beautiful cloud formations. And that combined with the dust that's kicked up during the day really does make for some of the best sunsets in the world. I agree, Kathy. This is Africa. And sometimes its beauty almost shocks one with its sort of incredible images. Okay. That was a nice, peaceful stop. I've got far too comfortable in my car seat. Time for us to move on and see what else we can find. I was on my way towards the hyena den. I got distracted by that incredible sunset. As you know, we've only got a couple of minutes of daylight left, probably about 20 or so minutes, so it's time for us to rush off there. And then hopefully after that, we will be able to go and figure out maybe where Karula's gone, or if Shadow decides to pay us a visit again. I just had to take us to a nice spot to watch the sunset. definitely feel the stirrings of winter. It's already a little bit nippy. We're no longer starting off our afternoon safaris feeling as though we are cameras. Sorry about that, just went a bit quiet. It seems as though our signal was breaking up a little bit on this road. Hopefully it improves as we go along Aubrey's Road towards the den site that has been so incredibly active over the last few days. We've spent quite a bit of time there just because we've been restricted to where Wendy can go. It is something that they are working on, and Wendy will be back up to full health very shortly. I'm sure. But it's just one of those things, the technology that's required to bring you something, to bring you images that are happening right here and now, all the way across the globe. And it does mean that every now and again things go a little bit wrong. Signal dips, sometimes the engines break down. It's just all part and parcel of the safari experience, a safari live experience. And I think until I get to the den and I'm stationary, because my voice is breaking up a bit, why don't you go back across to Brent?
Welcome. We are now perusing the eastern quadrant, so to speak, of Fuyatela, or Juma, as it's better known. And we're just going, stopping, listening for a possible alarm call, seeing what could possibly be out here. Now, I know Jamie's on her way to the hyena den, so hopefully she'll have some luck there and they'll be nice and active. I haven't heard any updates on the radio for a while. It's amazing how the cats evade us sometimes, and other times they're just lying in the road. Is that beautiful sky. So we're going to stop and listen again shortly and see what we can hear. Sometimes at this time of the night you do hear some wonderful bird calls, and I know you guys were chatting with Jamie about it earlier, and wondering if I got any of my own favorite bird calls. Of course I do. I think in this part of the world, although we don't really get them here on Juma, I think one of my favorites is the white-browed robin chat. And I'll play the call for you shortly. I haven't heard anything just yet. Oh, I'm pushing the wrong buttons there. Okay, there we go. Okay, so I was talking about one of my favorite bird calls, and that is the white-browed robin chat. Now, growing up in the areas I did, this is probably one of the calls we woke up to almost every morning. Beautiful, beautiful call. Takes me back. Get really excited, and they like to live on the edge of rivers. So quite often safari lodges and camps are on the edge of rivers. So I can remember many times lying in bed while it was still dark and just having the white-browed robin chats going absolutely bananas outside. It's also an incredibly beautiful bird. There you go. Very, very pretty. Okay, let's keep on trucking on. Heading back down towards the Mawati. But while we continue to search, let's jump back on to Jamie, who's made it all the way to the hyena den.
Back again at the hyena den for the last few moments of daylight. Always such a privilege getting to spend time with these wonderfully interesting animals. What I have noticed is that in the last 3 days that we've been here consistently, none of the hyenas have come back with enormously full bellies. So they haven't managed to either hunt successfully or hunt a large animal, and they haven't managed to find something to scavenge off. But we've got all 5 cubs around the entrance to the den site. Here you go, Kai. I hope you are still watching. You wanted to go to the hyena den. And we have arrived. Let us know if you are still watching, Kai, and that we've been able to provide what you wanted to see for your afternoon safari. Some sleepy faces here. Obviously, playtime is slowly drawing to a close, or maybe just a brief break in between the mischief that they get up to. I cannot believe how these hyena cubs have grown. Starting to look far more like miniature adults. There's the 2 newest arrivals, as far as we know, to this hyena den, and the cubs of the matriarch, from what we have observed. Misty, you were wondering on the subject of the matriarchy and the way in which hyena clans function. You were wondering what would happen if there was a sudden and unfortunate death of the matriarch. How long would it take the clan to establish a new matriarch? Would they be in disorder? Or would they potentially split up, for example? Misty, it's very much a circumstantial thing. It will depend on the hyenas themselves, and there's no exact right answer to your question. As I've often said before at the hyena den, we don't know everything there is to know about their social structure. My guess would be with this clan is that one of the madam's daughters will take over from her, possibly a high-ranking female, who could, both Corky and Pretty, could be madam's older daughters. Oh, but you are so cute. There's also the possibility, yes, of a split. Sometimes the different matrilineal lines will go their separate ways, as we have spoken about before. That's one of the ways in which new hyena clans are formed. It's quite a complex issue, and one that I don't have a precise answer for you. I don't think it would throw the clan into disarray. I think that a female, a high-ranking female, would probably step in or step forward automatically. There might be some power scuffles initially, whilst she establishes herself as the new head of the clan. But I don't think it would be a terribly long-winded process, that establishment. I think it is more likely that it will happen fairly quickly. Hyenas are so fascinating in terms of their social dynamics because it's something that constantly changes and that we are constantly becoming more and more aware of and learning more about. There, for example, is the matriarch herself with all those nicks and cuts in her ears. And sudden deaths do happen out here. It's a rough world. She could run foul of a lion or find herself bitten by a snake. Ooh. It's very interesting the way that Madam behaves around her cubs. She calls far more constantly to them than the other mothers do. Looks like Pretty just came in to investigate what was happening. Is that Pretty? Looks like it might be. To check up on what was going on with the cubs. And anal pasting. It's not Pretty, sorry. It isn't Pretty. I'm not sure which individual that is. But she definitely came in to investigate and immediately anal pasted around the den. Coming, well spotted, Jandre. The sub-adults returning to the den to be warmly received, I imagine, by the cubs. The sub-adults provide the perfect play companions. Going straight towards the other cubs. There you go, look at that. Look at how submissive that sub-adult is to a cub less than half its size. Isn't that fascinating, both of them? Look at the dominance being displayed by the cubs with their tails up in the air, and the sub-adult immediately presenting the genitals for sniffing. Looks like a male from the angle that we've got. In fact, I'm pretty sure this is, I think this might be Bella. So the older brother, of, or at least older half-brother of the matriarch. So the older siblings to these cubs. But as a male, automatically showing submission to the new high-ranking members. And that, there comes Mom to investigate as well. All cubs displaying a bit of cheek there. You can see it in the body language of the sub-adults being nipped on the bottom by sharp cub teeth is not ideal. Nope, I've had it. I'm out. Sensational has said that hyenas look almost like prehistoric dogs, and Kathy's wondering, sort of along a similar line, about. Oof. Shame. Ouch. I could literally hear that hyena saying ouch there. It's amazing how they've got, sorry guys, I will get back to this question in a moment, but it's amazing how they've got that initial, that instant instinct as cubs to go for the ears. The ears and the rump. And whenever we've witnessed actual hyena fights, that's exactly the parts that are targeted. And these cubs are not gentle in their attentions. So Kathy, on a similar line of the evolution, while we watch them maul this poor adult, you were wondering if they have evolved much in the last 1,000 years. And no, they've kept this design relatively similar in terms of a species evolution. I know that sensationalists said they look like prehistoric dogs. And it's so interesting, the fact, and it is far back, but it is interesting how they evolved initially, or that cats and hyenas share an ancestor rather than dogs and hyenas. But hyenas are neither cats nor dogs. They are a completely separate animal. There is the Canidae family of dogs. Wild dogs, for example, fall under that. Shame. You're getting bullied, you poor thing. So wild dogs, jackals, foxes, Cape foxes, bat-eared foxes, all fall under the Canidae family. Then we've got the Felidae, the big cats and the little cats, the servals of the world, the lions, and then there's the Hyenidae family. In this area, the spotted and the brown hyena are probably the ones that we are most likely to encounter. Brown hyena, less so, apparently has only been seen once. Oh, and now, are you curious by any chance? I'm coming to say hello. They get these frown lines of concentration in the middle of their foreheads. Look so serious. Ooh. Amazing how much braver these cubs are than the previous two sets in terms of coming close to the vehicle at this age. Oh, no, we're actually not that interesting, are we? So Shell agrees. She thinks that was Bella that we saw. I also think we've got June here as well. Shell, maybe you can confirm for me and our other experts. I mean, I don't know if Chris Rogue is watching, but it's slightly more difficult for me to identify them individually. I'm fairly certain this is Bella being mauled. And I think that we've got June's grown so much that I don't always instantly recognize him. Yes, I'm talking about you, coming up to the car. We were speaking about the different hyena species. Brent thinks he's seen tracks for an aardwolf here before, a much debated member of the hyena family, an entirely insect-eating species as opposed to a carnivore. Oof, is this roughhousing that's going to end in tears? Or hyena yelps. Amazing what they... Oh, shame. Poor Bella. The life of an almost adult male. Being constantly picked on. Had it, though. He's done. I've got... Somewhere in front of me, I have a hyena cub. In fact, I now have two hyena cubs that have moved straight under the car. I can't see exactly where they are, but I'm keeping a very close eye on the removable parts of the vehicle. Not unheard of for a hyena to snatch a cap covering a wheel. Michelle, watching in New Jersey, as the light slowly starts to fade. Ooh! Scatter! Panic! Don't know what that was about. Nothing too urgent, though. Michelle, you were just wondering whether or not hyenas have ever evolved a sort of an immunity or some kind of immunity to snake venom. Sorry, I'm just gently removing the spider web that's connecting me to the camera. Michelle, could well be. They probably do have a certain resilience when compared to us. A lot of the animals out here do have a degree of immunity to some venoms. Not complete immunity, but they often survive far better than we might when exposed to snake bites. Honey badgers, of course, being the prime example, but there's no reason why hyenas might respond differently to certain venom types. You are terribly brave, little one. Sorry, I know that you can't see the cover that's currently under the bonnet. I did have one sneak up on me the other night, and I looked down, I mean, it was basically at elbow height. Is he having a good sniff? It was one of the sub-adults. Is that cub has moved now, yes. All right. You've got to have eyes in your back of the head, in the back of your head at hyena den sightings, with all of the comings and goings. As you can see, it is getting a little bit dark. We always arrive for sort of the last few moments, but the hyenas are now starting to get... They're starting to go, the adults are starting to move off. Let's try that entire sentence again because the words just wouldn't come out right. Try that again. The adults are moving off and the cubs therefore are going to start moving back towards the den. As we don't put lights on them, I think it is time for us to depart from the hyena den and see what other things we can find. Who knows, last night we left the hyena den and promptly bumped into the wonderful Karula. Just strolling down the road. Admittedly, we had been tracking her for the better part of the afternoon. She nevertheless managed to evade me right up until the end. I'm just gonna sit quietly for 1 second because I think they're gonna do their whooping call. Beautiful, haunting sounds from the distance, but they're not going to call like I thought they were going to. All right, time for us to leave, see what else we can find. In the meantime, let's find out what Brent's been up to while we've been at the hyena den.
So it's getting dark, so hopefully we're going to have a little bit more luck with some of our nocturnal friends. I'm just getting my spotlight out. Where is it gone now? Should be around here somewhere. There it is. Oh, underneath my binoculars. That's why it's not coming out.
Andrew, come into the office.
Yes, Andrew. Okay. So we have heard that those Birmingham boys have got mobile, but unfortunately heading away from the edge of our traverse. So that's what Dave and I have been doing here, waiting patiently, hoping that they were going to start moving towards us. They're just down this road, but they are not coming this way, unfortunately. So we'll head towards that magnificent sky. So heading west at the moment. Curious, one would like to know how many dragons do the folklore stories in this part of the world say there are. Only one that I know of, and it's not really a dragon, but a really big serpent, a very wise creature that was not harmful at all, but used to try help the Shangaan people with medicine, used to live in a big hole in the ground. That's the only one that's sort of similar to a dragon that I know about in this part of the world. Can't remember its exact name now, it's quite a mouthful.
I remember reading about it quite a long time ago. I'll definitely have to do some more research on that. We're going to now head off the northern edge of our traverse and slowly make our way back towards the south and then down into that area where I last had Karula's tracks. Hopefully she decides to make an appearance after dark as she did last night. Chantal on YouTube asks, are there panther chameleons ever seen here? Apparently they're Madagascan species. So Chantal, we don't get any. We only have one species of chameleon here. It's called the flap-necked chameleon. I will keep a lookout for one tonight, but no panther chameleons. So Madagascar's got the highest number of chameleon species anywhere in the world, and almost all of them are endemic to Madagascar. So they only occur on Madagascar, which is an island off the east coast of Africa. So none of the Malagasy species will occur on mainland Africa. Well, mammal species at least. And reptiles, don't think there are any. Maybe crocodiles, I can't remember. I think maybe Nile crocodiles in Madagascar, but that's about it. Absolutely stunning evening. Now, the only thing that can make it a bit better is a leopard. Barbara, she's learnt from Safari Live to always pay attention wherever you might be. You never know what little things might be about. That is so true, Barbara. From the tiniest ant or ant lion or even a mantis, there's amazing creatures, big and small, wherever you might be. Is wondering, as you just mentioned dragons, doesn't the Drakensberg mountain means dragon's back? Not quite, it means dragon's mountains. So Bach is mountain in Afrikaans, and Draken is a dragon. So that is from the first Dutch colonists who thought they did look like a dragon's back, but they called it the dragon's mountains. So that's the Drakensberg, one of the longest mountain ranges in Africa. Not quite as long as the Andes though, which I think, I can't remember, I think the Andes is the longest mountain range in the world. And there's a big hole from the rain. And the Himalayas is the highest. And Mount Kilimanjaro in Africa is the highest freestanding mountain that is not attached to a mountain range.
Megan would like to know, do we have a lot of evergreen trees here? Megan, we have a few. The most common of the evergreen trees and the most important to a lot of the animals is the buffalo thorn, because it's evergreen but also highly nutritious. So you'll find a lot of the browsing species will feed off that during the dry months. Decided to have a quick look at the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. Doesn't look like anything's about. Wonderful temperature at the moment, just almost idyllic to be out on game drive in this temperature. So we actually got a really lovely question from Sensational on YouTube, who's a new viewer. So welcome to the Safari Live family, Sensational. And Sensational would like to know, do leopards only live in Africa? They don't. They're actually one of the more widespread big cats. So they occur from the southern tip of Africa right the way through into North Africa, in the Central African rainforests, in the Sahara Desert, and the Kalahari Desert. And they extend through the Middle East, Iran, and through Asia as well, and India, all the way through to Russia. Now there's a population less than 100 leopards in the Amur region of Russia, and genetically a subspecies from our leopards, but they would be able to breed and provide viable offspring, so they're not a separate species. So it's just a local variation, and obviously evolution's taking place and speciation's taking place because they are so distinct and so far from any other leopard population. And very good news that the Russian government is actually doing a splendid job there, and the population has nearly doubled in the last 10 years. So before, one of the biggest threats to the Amur leopards was being shot when they killed livestock. Now one of the largest insurance companies in Russia, as a sponsorship, they will pay out the farmer for any of its livestock, his livestock that might be killed by the leopard. Now, that is a really great and wonderful success story. Of course, not quite off the brink of the Amur leopards yet, less than 100 individuals left in the wild, but it is an amazing story. Now, leopards occur throughout India, and I know a lot of you have watched The Jungle Book or read Rudyard Kipling's classic. Now, Bagheera, the black panther, is actually a menelistic leopard. So a menelistic leopard is a genetic mutation where melanin, the dark color hormone or color or gene, takes precedence, and so a lot of the other colors don't come through. So there's no such thing really as a black or panther. A black panther is just a menelistic leopard. One of my favorite authors, Rudyard Kipling. Okay, we've got a bit of a traffic jam in here. And I'm not going to put the lights on the Ellies. Sometimes they don't like bright lights at night, so you can see I've just put the dims on. But we're just going to keep quiet, and I'm going to turn off all the lights and just listen to these elephants around us. We can kill this one as well too, please, Dave. Now, this is why you don't want to be wandering around in the African night. We are very, very vulnerable when it's dark. So I'm going to keep quiet and let's pop the sound up and just listen to these incredible noises around us.
Now, there's an elephant literally about 3 feet away from the vehicle, so I can't actually start and move the vehicle at the moment. She's got a little baby that I can just make out in the half light. All you can see is the flashing of the GoPros. So the rest of the herd is coming right up to us now. Just gonna let them go past. You just heard me tap the side of the vehicle there. The one cow came very close to grabbing that GoPro ball with her trunk. And that little tap, and she just moved off. So I turn on this side. So you can see we're literally surrounded by Ellies. Okay. Oh, we got one more coming. Sorry, little guy. I'll turn off my lights for you now. Okay, wasn't that incredible? That was amazing. So close to us. And now I'm half expecting a trumpet as we drive off from one of the little ones. Nope, not this time. Wow, that was amazing. Sorry I turned off all the lights, guys, but I don't want to upset the animals. So I wanted to let them pass peacefully. And in doing so, I couldn't have all the bright lights on. Elephants sometimes really don't like that the bright lights at night. So that's why I just turned them off. And it's amazing how much you can actually hear when you take away your sight. It's immediately some of your other senses sort of take over. Very, very interesting that. I always find that fascinating. Gracie. Gracie is one of our special regular viewers who's 8 years old. Gracie particularly loves elephants, and she just wanted to pop in and say hi, Brent, and that she loves elephants around me in the night. Absolutely awesome. I agree with you 100%, Gracie. Nice to have you on the game drive with us today. Okay, now we're through the elephants, we can pop the spotlight on again. So a big Safari Live welcome to Ghosty Girl Gamer, who has just discovered Safari Live. Well, welcome to the family. She says, OMG, this is amazing. And it is truly, it sometimes even baffles us that we are able to bring you a live safari from the middle of the African bush to wherever you might be sitting in whatever country you are in the world. So here we go. And our latest addition to the Safari Live family is from England. Well, it's a little bit warmer here, I must say. I battle with the English weather. And what you guys call summer is quite a cold winter for us out here. So I popped that GoPro out on that open field next to the buffalo skull to do a time lapse of the sunset. Let's hope the hyena hasn't beaten us back to the GoPro. I'm just checking, I'm making sure there are no tracks here. So I'm just gonna go pick it up quickly. Thank you.
Lady Macbeth said she didn't know GoPros could do time lapses. That's so cool. It is very cool, and they are incredibly useful for time lapses because they're so wide. And they're small enough that you can just pop them around, leave them, and hopefully they don't disappear. Now, I've had friends who have lost a few GoPros to various different critters. One to lion. I nearly lost one to a lion when I was filming with Kevin Richardson. I know hyenas have stolen a few, elephants have stolen a few, but quite interestingly, when you work on a big budget sort of documentary, which I've worked on a few, the head cameraman always joked, they call GoPros disposable cameras. So they're willing to put them in quite risky spots to get the shot. My GoPro came closest to retiring on the Kafue River in Zambia. I was driving a speedboat between some rapids, very technical boat driving, and at the same time driving a boat and trying to hang a GoPro off the side, and my GoPro clipped a rock. Now, fortunately, that's why they have those wonderful cases. The GoPro survived, the case did not. Whoa! That was a large dung beetle, nearly went flat into my head. Fortunately, it hit the dashboard and bounced over. It looked like quite a large dung beetle. I think that might have given me a black eye if it had connected at the speed it was flying with the speed we were driving. One of the highest flying insects, being recorded at 37,000 foot above sea level, dung beetles at the same height as commercial airliners. Oh, little Stenborkie. So we do have a few new viewers on board with us. So you notice I turned my lights off for the Ellies. I also won't be shining on any of the impala, zebra, things like that. The spotlight can blind the diurnal, daytime animals a little bit. So, there's more impala. So we will shine on the nocturnal animals. Their eyes are set up a bit differently. So they are able to withstand the spotlight without any effect on them. But with impala and zebra and giraffe and things like that, they do get blinded for a short while. Now, good, it's still there. The hyena hasn't taken it. I can just see the red popping on and off over there. There we go. Let's just pick it up quickly before the hyenas manage to walk off with it, because I'm pretty sure they'll see that flashing light and decide, that's very interesting. Maybe I should see what it tastes like. Now, hyenas have eaten many strange things that I've found them eating over the years. Oh! Do alarm calling. Just trying to get a direction. Okay, I've got it. I've got them. Okay, we've got where the kudu alarm calling. It sounds very close to us. I wonder what it could be. So when kudu alarm like that, it's generally lion or leopard. So fingers crossed. So welcome to First Kalina High School and Mrs. Wyckoff's class. We are chasing off after kudu alarm calls. So when animals out here spot lion or leopard, they literally tell all the other animals that there's something there. So that kudu's going, bah. He could be saying lion, or he could be saying leopard. but we're going to go find out. Hopefully, it does sound quite close to our eastern edge of our boundary, but we're going to have a look anyway. So fingers crossed that whatever those kakudu are alarming at is visible. I'm hoping for leopard personally, but it could be a big male lion. So we are right on the eastern edge of our traverse area. I would say those kudu were alarming just there. So let's see. And this is a very popular thoroughfare road for lots of animals. Now, a lot of the roads here are built on old game paths. So a very good place to look for predators. They also like to walk down roads. We're just going to turn off and I'm going to listen for a little bit. So while I listen, let's go see what Jamie's up to, and hopefully we'll be back with a big cat.
Hello and welcome to the end part of our sunset safari. Oh, this is a wonderful time to be driving out and about at night in the bush. I hear that Brent's been racing about to follow up on alarm calls from kudu, the deepest bark in the African bush, a deep bark sound. I'm sure he's already mentioned to you, but it's only really the lions and the leopards and the cheetah that a kudu will alarm call for like that. Last night, we got so extraordinarily lucky. Brent had a leopard hunting on Sandy Patch called Shadow, and I had her mother, Karula, just outside our camp. We actually drove past and saw the camp wall. We're hoping that Karula, at least, might make an appearance tonight, but you never know what you might encounter being out in the dark like this. Now, Eva, you were wondering what animals are more active at night. Leopards and lions, the nocturnal hunters, the apex nocturnal predators, as well as spotted hyena. And then we've got a wide variety of different nocturnal creatures. And that's one of the reasons why I said that you've jumped on board at the right time. Because it is starting to get cooler, our African summer is coming to an end, and autumn is approaching, it means that the rarer nocturnal species are starting to come out earlier. Something like a honey badger, which I'm sure many of you have heard of, an aardvark, or an anteater. We could see porcupine, white-tailed mongoose, jackal, serval. We saw a serval the last time I drove along this road, straight after the end of the drive. It's a medium-sized cat that looks a little bit like a cheetah. So all sorts of things that you could see, but here is a good example of an animal that is active at night. Now watch is the Shangaan name. Oh, he's changed his mind. He's going to come across the road. An African scrub hare. You only ever see them active during the night time. During the day, they sleep up under bushes and safe places like that. I'm going to rest my arm like that. That's scrub hare. We don't have any rabbits, but I was wondering whether any of you might know the difference between a hare and a rabbit and the way in which we refer to them. There is a distinctive difference. Now, we don't get rabbits in this area, but we do have rabbits in the country that you find in South Africa. I wonder whether any of you can tell me one of the main differences between a hare and a rabbit. Can you see that light shining from his eye? That is the reflection of the tapetum lucidum, the layer at the back of the eye that reflects ambient light and enhances ambient light and allows the animal to see far better than we could ever imagine in the dark. Frodo, you were wondering, we're sitting here with our lights on and with my spotlight in hand, whether there are any irritating bugs that fly around at night. At the moment, we have a wide variety of moths and termites that have been the reproductive members of the termites that have come through to a sort of a population explosion. I believe that Brent just got quite thoroughly smacked in the face by a very large dung beetle. So yes, all of the beetles out here attracted to the lights of our vehicles. It's something you get used to really quickly, though. I've never been particularly bothered by it. It is starting to get a little bit cooler. As you can see, though, I'm still in my shirt. Nate was wondering, how cold does it get here at night? And the answer is, depending on the season, round about now, it's probably dropping to around 20 degrees centigrade. So close to around 74, 75 degrees Fahrenheit, roughly. Now, once we get to winter, it will drop around between 0 to 4 degrees centigrade, so 32 to about 39 in Fahrenheit. That will be our usual temperature for our evenings. In summer, however, it's a completely different story, and the temperature very rarely drops below 30 degrees, which is 86 in Fahrenheit. So as you can imagine, some of the nights are quite hot and quite difficult to sleep at times. And then, of course, you've also got all of the bugs and mosquitoes in particular. Now, mosquitoes out here, I'm sure many of you know about the possibility of malaria. Very, very low risk area that we're in at the moment. In other words, not many mosquitoes carry it. And a lot of tourists, when they come to visit, are very panicky about the possibility of contracting malaria from mosquito bites. It's important to remember that the female Anopheles mosquito, the one that carries the malaria parasite, she won't travel much more than about a kilometer in distance, so less than a mile of distance that she will fly. And she has to bite somebody infected with malaria and then cover some distance and bite another person in order to transmit it. The chances of that happening are very, very slim in a situation like we're in with very few people about. It's only really when people go home to the local surrounding villages that, and then return to work, that malaria potentially spreads. But it's something that, if caught early, is not at all serious. Now, I have another question for you. Let's see if we can get an answer to this. I'm driving along and I'm seeing a load of white stuff on the side of the road. Let me try not to burn it out too much. Let me go forward a bit, it's not the best view. Let's see if you can figure out what animal might be responsible for this. It is scat. In other words, it is predator poo. And I wonder if you can figure out why it is so white in color and what might have been responsible for that. I'll give you some time to mull over that. In the meantime, I'm sure you're all eager to find out how Brent's leopard search has gone. So let's hear it from him.
Welcome back, guys. Sorry, I'm just on the Game Dive channel. I said it was Ingwe calling. Sounded like just Mulwanini, that area from the from Chilakatlan Junction with Gary Main. So just letting the other guys know, unfortunately that leopard, I heard him call. Now, a leopard, it sounded like a male to me, a territorial call. So one of the reasons they call is to let all the other leopards know that this is their spot. And it is called a rasp, or a saw, is what a leopard call is described as. And it goes something like, I just need to prepare myself, something like this. So there we go, that's what a leopard's territorial call sounds like. Now, very interesting there is that only members of the Panthera genus are able to do that. So the big cats that are able to make big noises all belong to the genus Panthera. So jaguars, lions, tigers, leopard, and I think that's it. So in all cat species, they have a hyoid bone or a hyoid apparatus. And what that is a little bone in their throat. And in the small cats, that little bone is solid. So in your domestic cat, that's why he can't roar. Hello. That's why he can't roar. But with lion, leopard, jaguar, they have their hyoid bone is not solid, it is elastic, it's almost cartilaginous, and the vibration of that is what enables them to make a very big sound. Oh, I saw a bush baby, but he disappeared very quickly. So Matt is wondering, does driving near the animals affect their hunting? It can do, Matt, but animals will give, their body language gives away signs. So if we see an animal start stalking, oh, I'm being attacked by dung beetles tonight. If an animal starts stalking, their body language changes and we immediately turn off the lights. It's not so much the vehicle, but the light that can affect their hunting. Either it'll show the possible prey species, where the predator is, or if you keep the light on the prey species, you can blind them, making it easier for the lion or leopard to catch them. So we don't want to interfere. So if we see an animal is actively stalking, we'll switch off all the lights and we'll just listen to what happens. So either alarm calls will be given, the animal has been spotted, the chase is up, and then we'll go look at it, or they'll manage to catch something and we'll hear that noise. But now we're going to move away from the big cats. And Jamie has got one of the more interesting many-legged creatures to show you.
Not a big cat, or in fact a mammal, but a fascinating little arthropod. Oopsie, sorry buddy. Known as a millipede. And just look at all of his legs, try and see. I know it's difficult and I'm trying not to let him escape. But the way in which his legs move almost in waves as he moves forward. They are such fascinating creatures. Yeah, look at his legs. Look at the way they move. Hello. Hello. Oh, my goodness. Are you coming to say hello? Here we go. Let's catch you here before you crawl up my shoulder. So a millipede, the local sort of colloquial term for them, is a shongololo. And it is a perfectly, entirely harmless little arthropod. Unlike its caterpillar cousin, oh sorry, not caterpillar, caterpillar is also harmless. Unlike its centipede cousin, it is completely harmless to us unless we eat it. So it's an animal that carries a cyanide type substance within it that would be toxic to humans. And it's one of those amazing things about the ways that animals are adapted out here, that there is always something adapted to be able to utilize resources, no matter how seemingly toxic those resources may be. In this case, there is an animal known as a civet that you could well see whilst we drive around at night that makes a meal of a millipede. Look at him go. All right, buddy, thank you very much. Sorry, I plucked him from the road in order to show you, so I'm just going to jump out and return him back to his rightful place before we move on and see what else we can find. Bear with me one moment. Okay. Now, one very important thing to note as I got out of the vehicle now, we spend a lot of time walking in the bush, but we don't do so at night, and there's a very good reason for that. At night, animals respond entirely differently to us as human beings. And the reason behind that is that we are not the dominant predator at night. So, Nate, you were wondering about the feline's night vision compared to a human's. Now, Nate, if I were to turn off all of my lights, the camera would probably light and be able to brighten up a little bit the surrounding areas. But for the most part, human beings with our night vision, we're fairly lacking. And unless it's a full moon night, we would struggle to navigate in the bush in the dark. A cat, however, any one of the cats, is able to see almost as clearly as it does during the day. And that has to do with that reflective layer that I was talking about. One of the things has to do with the reflective layer that I was chatting about with the scrub hair. What I'm going to do... No, I don't think so. I'm not going to. There's a group of impala, but I don't want to stress them out. And there's one slightly nervous scrub here. Well done, Tasha. As our scrub hair hops away, shame, I'm actually going to leave it. You can see just by its body language and with its ears back that it's a little bit scared. Let's leave it be. To go about, it's got enough things to be scared of without us adding to it. Natasha, very well done. You were right about why the dung is white. It is white because of the diet of the animal. And when I tell you the answer, it'll be really clear about why that is. The dung that we were looking at, or the scat is the correct term for a carnivore poo, is from a spotted hyena. Now, spotted hyenas, unlike the other animals out here, have powerful bone-crushing jaws and are capable of consuming bones at a far higher level than leopards or lions. Leopards and lions can eat bones, the softer, smaller ones, but they're not capable of utilizing and crushing the bones in the same way hyenas are. And that is why, because of the high levels of calcium in their feces, that is why it turns white over time. Our chase, while we drive around at night, and we spoke a bit about nocturnal predators, you were wondering about what animal is at the top of the food chain. Chase at night, it is the lion. And in fact, during the day, it is also the lion to an extent. The reason I'm sort of saying that not quite accurate is because human beings are the dominant predator during the day. Even though in this particular area, it is obviously a conservation area, times have changed, we are geared towards protecting the animals rather than hunting them. But at night, it is most definitely the lion. Now, we're coming to the end of your class, and I believe that you're all going on spring break soon, so I hope that you have a wonderful time. It's been great having you on the back of the vehicle, albeit for a brief few minutes. Have a wonderful time, and I hope to see you back with us once again. Cheers.
So we've got time for one last question from Devon, who would like to know, what is the coolest thing I've seen on drive? Well, Devon, I think since I've been doing the live drives, the coolest thing is definitely the Inkahuma pride, stalking, catching and killing an adult buffalo bull. And it was amazing, and I think it was probably the first live buffalo kill ever caught on camera. So really, really exciting and an incredible sequence of events. You can actually have a look at that video on our YouTube channel. So it's nearly the end. Unfortunately, no cats tonight, but thanks to Mrs. Wyckoff's class for joining us, and we'll see you again soon. Bye-bye for now.